Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the sixth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. Before I begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff present that social distancing measures continue to remain in place in committee rooms of the Parliament like this, and in addition, a face covering must be worn if you are moving around the room or entering or leaving the room, but you can take your face masks off if you're sat down at the table. The first item for the committee is to consider whether or not to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Do we agree that?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And we now turn to the first principal item of business on our agenda this morning, which is to consider the Audit Scotland 2020-21 audit of the Scottish Government consolidated accounts. And I'd like to welcome our witnesses this morning, in particular to the new-ish Permanent Secretary, John Paul Marks. You're very welcome here in what I hope will be the first of a number of appearances before us in this session. The Permanent Secretary is joined in the room this morning by Jackie McAllister, who's the Chief Financial Officer, and by Colin Cook, who's the Director of Economic Development. And we have joining us virtually Leslie Fraser, who's the Director General Corporate, and Alison Stafford, who's the Director General of the Scottish Exchequer of the Scottish Government. So as I say, can I welcome John Paul Marks to his first meeting of a Scottish Parliament committee. This is the Public Audit Committee in his new role. And can I invite you, Permanent Secretary, to make a short opening statement?
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to the committee, and good morning to everyone. I'd like to start with a big thanks to my team for their support over the last few weeks. As you say, I started this job back at the very beginning of January, so it's lovely to meet the committee early on and look forward to working with you in the future. I think I'd start with three key points to make around the 2021 accounts. The first point is the budget scale-up for the Scottish Government and for the team was unprecedented, and it reflects the pandemic context that that the team faced, so up 27%, up 10 billion on the previous year. So a huge scaling up, and of course that enabled Scotland to deliver essential support at a critical time. And that continues to an extent, of course, through this year. We published the strategic framework this week in terms of the next steps with regards to the pandemic. But nonetheless, for 2021, three budget revisions in year and over £8 billion of additional consequential funding, which is the highest it's ever been. Nonetheless, credit the team successfully balancing the books at year end with the resource variance within 1%, which was an important achievement. Some capital underspends from financial transactions as well, but with the carry forward, that money was protected into this year's budget. So I think my first impressions is that the foundations, the accounting basis of these accounts is robust, and I'm really grateful to Stephen and his team for their input and ultimately for their unqualified opinion, confirming the account's true and a fair view, following accounting standards and lawful. I think on 21-22, to an extent, these trends continue, although the in-year consequential was around half what it was in 2021. But certainly for me, joining in early January, in the middle of what was the Omicron peak, the response from the NHS, from resilience partnerships, from local governments has been exceptional. And of course, we continue to remain vigilant to the challenge of numbers of admissions to hospital slightly up on recent data, and the numbers in hospital still at a level that puts us in that medium risk range. I agree with Audit Scotland's judgment that there are areas for us to continue to focus on. Fraud and error control, we'll come on to. Governance strengthening, where there's opportunities for us. A focus on delivery and performance, which is something I'm very determined to lead out with. and our support for private sector companies. So we learn from our experience over recent years. We are developing a framework for that in terms of our guidance, and something we seek to publish shortly. Just in terms of the future, we're working on our spending review now so that we can set a multi-year plan for the Parliament. From my perspective, that is a great opportunity. Obviously, we intend and hope for that plan to be strategic, prioritised, and ultimately be effective in achieving the outcomes in our national performance framework at year end. And you will see in the next few weeks and months a lot of focus on things like child poverty and the delivery plan on national strategy for economic transformation. And it's been good to see some progress in January around things like ScotWind, Green Freeports and other initiatives that will help us make progress in the years ahead. I'll pause there, Convener, but hopefully that's a helpful introduction. Thanks.
Yes, thank you very much indeed, Permanent Secretary. And if you do feel the need, as I'm sure you might over the course of the next hour or so, the need to bring in any of your colleagues, then please do that. And similarly, if Leslie and Alison, who are online, if you want to come in at any point, if you could put an R in the chat function, and we'll make sure that you get a call to give your evidence. I just want to begin with a short point before going over to the rest of the committee for questions. You mentioned governance being an issue and an area where perhaps more work is required. We took evidence on the 27th of January from Michael Oliphant, the Audit Director in Audit Scotland, where he told us that there were some concerns about perhaps over-ambition. And I think what Mr. Oliphant told us was that target dates and scores can sometimes be over-ambitious, and that there is therefore something the Auditor General has reflected on previously, an implementation gap. So I think what we wanted to understand from you is whether or not there is going to be some reflection on that part of the Audit Scotland report into the consolidated accounts, whether you're going to look at the need for perhaps more clarity on the action that's been taken so that we better understand how risk management is being carried out and how risks are being addressed by the Scottish Government.
So I recognise this is always an opportunity for big organisations to focus on. And it starts with, you know, have we got the right strategy in place? Are we clear what the success factors are for determining what success would look like? Our national performance framework does that very well on a long-term basis integrated into our accounts. But I agree with you, Convener, and Audit Scotland's advice here is really valuable in terms of the short and medium term and our capacity to evidence that we are indeed shifting the dial on the outcomes we all care about. So, you know, if I take drug death rates, we now have that data quarterly. We have investment going in of around 50 million a year over 5 years. So it's a significant investment. And we all want to, of course, see the drug death rate come down and see that data reflect that investment. And we have a team very focused on that delivery plan. Same is true for child poverty. You'll see also when we publish our delivery plan there, and when we come forward with the National Strategy on Economic Transformation, trying to be very clear about what are we trying to achieve strategically and what are the indicators for success along the way. One of the things I've put in place since arriving is we call it the delivery executive. We meet every Thursday, every week with the executive team to talk about these key priorities in terms of the outcomes we're seeking to achieve. What are the short, medium and long-term activities that we are delivering to achieve those outcomes? And then to an extent, what's our delivery confidence that those are translating successfully? And I think we're very happy to work with Audit Scotland on how we develop the annual report and accounts to include more of that reporting. At the moment, I'm impressed by the way the National Performance Framework integrates into the accounts nicely, but I think we can build on that in the years ahead.
Thank you. I think that's useful because I know that oftentimes in the Parliament there is lots of debate around the inputs and not necessarily sufficient concentration on the outcomes. So That's very helpful. Sharon Dowie wants to ask a question. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. In the report, paragraph 71, it mentions that over the last year, there were several changes to the Scottish Government's Corporate Board. In paragraph 72, the level of change will continue into next year. It also mentions the DG Economy and DG Net Zero were unsuccessful in identifying appointable candidates, and these have been filled on an interim basis and will be re-advertised in early 2022. It also notes four non-executive directors will reach the end of their term in 2022. So there's an awful lot of change and uncertainty there. So what or how does the Scottish Government intend to ensure stability and certainty within its leadership group? And what plans are in place to manage its governance arrangements during this period?
Thank you. It's a really important question. And I guess my arrival is a start of, as you say, stability. So I've been working with Ronnie Hines, our lead non-executive director. I meet him very regularly. In terms of the corporate board and the non-executives there, we have been able to extend some end dates for some of those non-executives to provide a bit more stability. And we've also recruited an additional three non-executives that will shortly be announced. So, and I signed off on those appointments, which was nice for me to be able to do early in my tenure. And their experience and leadership will be a fabulous contribution to the corporate board. I've met all the non-executives. We've got a great diversity of capability that supports the team, and the non-execs are then integrated, for example, into the boards of things like our Child Poverty Board or our boards on constitutional reform. So we have that good governance there. I think Audit Scotland have been fair in recognising some of the strengths of our governance, but nonetheless, we want to continue to improve those. Just in terms of Eleanor Mitchell and Roy Brannan, if I could, I consider both of them to be fabulous director generals. Roy Brannan brings huge depth of complex infrastructure and major projects experience to my team. So back to the convener's initial question around delivery, having a DG like Roy around the table focused on things like ScotRail coming into public ownership, net zero, and how you actually translate the 2045 ambition into a roadmap that gives us confidence that we're on track. His skill set is a great match. Similarly, Eleanor Mitchell, you know, has accountancy background, has been an interim DG before in social care. She has great HR depth of experience as well. And she is bringing that operational delivery clarity to the organisation of our economic portfolio. So again, we're clear on what it takes to actually deliver an underlying improvement in our growth rate. We will complete those roles, but I want to complete the spending review first with the stability of those two individuals in my executive team, and then we'll return to that process later in the year.
Right, okay, thank you.
Thank you. Willie Coffey's now got a question which he wants to put to you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Permanent Secretary. I wanted to ask a question on the Scottish Government's investment and financial support that we provided to private companies that's mentioned in the Auditor-General's report. And one of the significant ones, as far as I'm concerned, is a nearshore MSP's Prestwick Airport. Could you give us a brief outline of why that investment was made, and what would the implications have been had that investment not been made in Prestwick Airport?
Well, that's a pretty complicated question about a counterfactual that is hard to make a judgment on, but I understand why the question. I had a conversation with the sponsor team yesterday. I'm looking forward to visiting Prestwick and sitting down with the new chair. The new board, as you know, was appointed just before Christmas, I think in October last year, to talk about Prestwick's current position and its long-term future. I recognise, I think, just over 200 people are directly recruited into the airport, and then it supports a supply chain of a numbers of thousands of jobs in the area. So I can absolutely understand why the decision was made to protect jobs, protect industry and support that local community for an asset that was at that time in distress. I can't sit here and provide you with a value for money judgment on the counterfactual for something that happened in the past before I arrived, but what I can absolutely confirm is I will be sitting down with the chair and with the team, understanding the position now, and I would expect us to do periodic reviews of all these investments over time, and then of course keep the committee up to date on value for money judgments and advise ministers on their choices.
We know that there are around about 300 jobs there directly and about 1,400 jobs, spin-off jobs associated in the wider Ayrshire economy. And we know that the airport is pivotal to the Ayrshire authorities in terms of taking the Ayrshire growth deal forward and their hopes and aspirations for the spaceport possibility in Ayrshire. I just ask again, and perhaps your officials who have been on post perhaps longer than yourself, Mr Marks, had the Scottish Government not made that investment, would the airport still be functioning?
Well, Colin, I'll give you that opportunity to come in. I mean, I absolutely recognise your point. So, I mean, I'll just check in my latest numbers. You say 238 direct recruited jobs, 4,000 indirect within the supply chain, an important asset. You can understand absolutely why the government made the choice at that time. And then, as I say, sitting down with the board to talk about what comes in the future. But Colin, do you want to say anything about what would have happened if they had not stepped in?
I think, as you said, Permanent Secretary, I think it's impossible to speculate on what might have happened. I think what we should focus on is the fact that the airport is has developed a very strong niche. As an operating function, it has a specialism in fuel and specialist cargo. So I think it's got a very robust model going forward. As you know, we had over the past few years some fairly credible expressions of interest in taking on the airport. So I think its reputation is getting stronger, and I think we're looking forward to a very positive future for that airport.
It's hugely important for us in Ayrshire, but from a financial perspective, the committee and the Auditor General are thinking about and asking about the financial implications of the longer term support in the absence of finding a current buyer. Are you able to say anything at all about progress in that regard?
Well, I think. Sorry, forgive me. I think the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy made a statement in Parliament back in January that said and repeated that our long-term aim is to, as it has been from the start, is to return the airport to the private sector. That remains our aim. So I think we're in a very positive place there. As you know, we have a debt. There is a debt payable back to the Scottish Government, but that legally at least remains payable in. At a time in the future, and I think there's a very strong working relationship between ourselves, Transport Scotland, the airport, and we're open-minded to all sorts of futures about how we find a bidder, how the debt is structured, how the debt might be restructured in the future. We want to do the best, as you've been pointing out, Mr. Coffey, for the region of Ayrshire, and to make sure that that airport continues to add value and continues to support jobs, well-paid, good jobs, and an infrastructure in that area.
Thank you for that. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. There has also been considerable public interest in another financial arrangement the government has, and that's with the GFG Alliance. And the Audit Scotland report particularly focuses on the Lochaber Alley minimum smelter deal. What is the total financial exposure of the Scottish Government in relation to that deal?
So, you can imagine I've been getting into the GFG position and looking at Lochaber, and also we just talked about Prestwick, Ferguson's, Liberty Steel, all our private investments to reflect on where we are. One of the things that's important to my leadership is then going out to visit these sites, to meet the teams, to understand the impacts in communities. And we are trying to ensure that we have consolidated the capabilities for managing these investments in a single division, and then developing our framework, advice and guidance for how they are managed and how we would make these decisions in the future. We've had good input from Audit Scotland, and we are going to seek to publish that framework, I think, at the end of March. So we'll get all of that to the committee. I think in terms of latest financial exposure on Lochaber specifically, in the 2021 accounts, we disclosed a provisional figure in relation to the guarantee increasing from 33 million in the 18-19 accounts to 37 million in 19-20 and then 161 million in 2021. And we can, Colin and I can reflect a bit more on what makes that change happen given the accounting treatment.
I think it's worth starting, as we did in the discussion around Prestwick, by saying, you know, this is a critical strategic asset. It's the last remaining aluminium smelter in the United Kingdom, and it's a valuable and important part of employment in the West Highlands. Now, I might defer to the CFO when it comes to the technicalities of the accounting. But I am the director responsible for this in the Scottish Government, and perhaps I can give a little bit of context to explain that movement. Right up at the end of the financial year, very close to the financial year, Greenshill Capital UK Limited went into administration, and they were the main provider of finance to the GFG Alliance in general. And inevitably, therefore, that put a pressure on GFG Alliance and triggered a global refinancing and restructuring within that group. So it was within that context, something that happened towards the end of the financial year, that we worked with Deloitte, who are our advisors on this, on whether the provision in the accounts was at the right level. I think it's also probably worth saying that ministers have no role in setting that level. So despite the fact that there's no contractual default or anything like that at the end of March 2021, we decided to take a very, very prudent approach and classify the guarantee as credit impaired. Now, as I said, I might defer to the CFO, but that's stage three of the IFRS methodology. And previously, it had been classified as stage two, which is about a significant increase in credit risk. So In summary, yes, that figure has moved, but the provision has been determined on a very, very cautious basis. It's been determined as if, essentially, a default has occurred and that asset recovery is at the lower end of the spectrum. But no such default has occurred, and our central planning assumption is that any exposure from the guarantee would actually be covered by the security package that the government enjoys over the Lochaber asset. And that is a very strong security package. It includes significant land holdings and, of course, the smelter. So I think we're in a very strong position there.
Well, I mean, the evidence we took from the Auditor General on the 27th of January was he described the deal between the Scottish Government and the GFG Alliance entered into as a complex transaction, were his words. And he said that, again, to quote the Auditor General, there is an increasing likelihood that the guarantee will be called upon. So is that a strong position?
I think it's worth repeating that the level of provision or the provision that is made does not imply that a loss has occurred, nor indeed does it imply that a loss will occur. And it certainly doesn't impact upon SG's spending or Scottish Government's budget. So I think that remains the case. Of course, the GFG Alliance is going through a global restructuring. There are some well-known financial issues that they are dealing with. But as regards the Lochaber asset. As I said, we believe that the value of our the provision is more than covered by the security package that we have when it comes to protecting the public finances. That includes the smelter, it includes the hydro, it includes some extensive land holdings. The value of those assets in the accounts of GFG Alliance is in excess of the level of security that, is in excess of the level of the guarantee that we've provided. So I think we're in a, a robuster position as one can be from a financial point of view at the moment. And to repeat, we are in a very robust position because we have protected really valuable jobs and a really valuable strategic asset in the West Highlands.
Mr. Cook, and I'm going to call Jackie McAllister in a second, but I mean the facts of the matter are that the GFG Alliance in the last couple of weeks has been brought to book by HMRC. Mm. It's the subject of an investigation by the Serious Fraud Office. As you mentioned earlier, Permanent Secretary, Greensill Capital has collapsed. And there are question marks around the governance structure of the GFG Alliance itself. So I just wonder from the perspective of the Scottish Government, as a, almost a partner in this enterprise, a party to a deal with the GFG Alliance, what contingency plans are you making?
Well, we have and we've continued to plan on a contingency basis. You will be aware, convener, of a statement that was made in Parliament in respect of the Liberty Steel transaction, which was as a direct result of the contingency planning that was carried out by the Scottish Government. I think it's worth saying that the HMRC have indeed, yes, they have lodged winding up petitions against four organisations within the GFG Alliance in England. But at the present time, the Scottish plants are not part of that. Now, it is a complicated group, and there are undoubtedly arrangements across that group. There may well be loans from one part to the other, so there is always a potential that the actions of the HMRC do spill over into the assets in Scotland. But at the moment, that's not the case. And my team work very closely with local management at the Scottish plants in respect of Lochaber. We have regular meetings about the guarantee, so we keep a very close watch on what is happening. And the Minister, Ivan McKee, has visited the sites recently, spoken, be very impressed, I understand, by the plans and the operational plans. So we're keeping a very close eye on it. Of course, GFG Alliance is a major international group. Of course, they have some difficulties. They are in the middle of a global restructuring, and we will take the action that's required to protect those jobs and those organisations going forward.
Okay, I did say that Jackie McAllister wanted to come in, so I'll invite Jackie in just now.
Thank you. Just very briefly to build on the accounting treatment and indeed Audit Scotland's comments around that. Just to be clear, the provision that Colin was talking about is an expected credit loss. It's a requirement for all organisations under the accounting standards to make an assessment of the credit risk. And that is essentially, there's a set of underlying credit risk scenarios that are run to come up with this calculation. And that includes, you know, the credit strength of the organisation and associated organisations. And that calculation is what has driven the increase from 37 million to 161 million. And indeed, Audit Scotland confirmed that they considered that to be a reasonable provision, a reasonable expected credit loss. Clearly, that is something that we continue to keep under review. Thank you.
Thank you. But I mean, I will move on in a second, but I mean, just to underline the fact that this is within the space of a year, a quadrupling of that assessment of the exposure to risk. So, I mean, if that was my own personal financial situation, I would be alarmed at such an increase in the expected or the assessed exposure to financial risk. Is the Scottish Government not alarmed by the quadrupling of that exposure?
So at this point, there is no call on the Scottish Government guarantee. There is no debt owed to the Scottish Government. So all of the fees that are due with respect to the guarantee are up to date. And just to reiterate the point that has been made, there is a comprehensive security package in place as well.
If I
may. Yes, of course, yes.
Convener, I think it's also worth pointing out that that level of provision does or can move. And if the global credit position of the GFG alliance does improve, then that does often open up the scope and does suggest that the level of the provision may well change in future.
Colin Beattie wants to come in, so Colin, on the right.
Yeah. Just to pick up on a point that Colin Cook made there, when you were referring to the value of the assets, you referred to the book value of the assets. Is that what we're relying on, the book value of the assets, as opposed to the market value of the assets?
I quoted the last time that I have a figure that has been quoted, which was the fact that GFG valued the assets in their 2019 accounts at 438 million. That's the figure I quoted. So that's I don't have a more up-to-date figure on the asset value based on current market conditions.
So we're actually basing this on the book value of the assets according to the company?
To the GFG Alliance in 2019, yeah. Which I think, as I said, gives us a fair degree of certainty that that's is sufficient to cover the exposure that the Scottish Government has had to this process.
And how often are you going to revisit that to ensure that the value of the assets are not impaired?
I think that's something that when we have our quarterly guarantee meetings, we review management accounts, we review business performance, we look at progress against the business plan, and I think that all informs the value of those assets. But the value of the assets comes from the land, it comes from the smelter, it comes from the hydro. It is a complicated picture, and we can keep that under review, Mr. Beattie.
Okay.
Thank you. I'm going to now move our questioning along and invite Craig Hoy to ask some questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Marks, and welcome to the committee and congratulations on your relatively new role. I'd like to turn to the transparency issue, and particularly the transparency in reporting around the record amounts of money that were spent last year and the year before in relation to the COVID pandemic. Obviously, you summarised at the beginning, we saw record amounts of money being pumped in, £10.7 billion more in 2021 than the prior year, £8.6 billion emanating from Barnett consequentials from the UK government in that year, and also a budget underspend of £580 million. So just looking at those figures, would you agree with the Auditor General's report that there should perhaps now be greater transparency in the government's financial reporting of those COVID-related expenditures?
So I'm really happy to sit down with Stephen Boyle and his team and talk about what more would help with regards to improving transparency in our annual report and accounting. My first impression is that we're in a robust place, as I said, in terms of the fundamental quality and level of prudence and professionalism that is going into the annual reporting, which to an extent is covered in the Auditor General's opinion. And if I go to the accounts we're talking about here with regards to 2021, I think three in-year budget revisions were made, statements to Parliament around all of those and explanations for those changes. And, you know, I note since I've arrived, I think the First Minister makes a statement to Parliament pretty much every week on our latest position on COVID, the latest data, business support, and the other investments that we've been seeking to make to maximise value for money in our response. And, of course, we published on Tuesday our strategic framework, which sets out in detail the latest position. But I think in terms of further work that we could do on transparency, going back to the conversation we had at the beginning with the convener's question, we want to build on the national performance framework integrated within our accounts to give a good record of how the delivery is translating into outcomes. But Jackie may want to say a bit more about the conversations on transparency to date, because I know there are, you know, wider public sector accounts is a staged approach that we're looking at. So there are things that we can do to put more data and more a contribution into Parliament and for the committee to see where spend is happening. But Jackie, do you want to build on that a bit?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, just to reinforce what the Permanent Secretary said there, we thoroughly agree on the need for transparency. We recognise that the public interest, and the Permanent Secretary set out a number of ways that we've sought to do that through 2021. We did enhance the accounts with some additional disclosures, and there are additional sets of information, data sets already in the public domain. We've also continued to think about how we can be more transparent. Indeed, this week, the Finance Committee has received the Spring Budget Revision Guide, which provides, again, additional transparency in terms of the COVID budget that has been allocated and spent. We also agree with Audit Scotland that it's complex. So I think they set out in their publication on following the pandemic pound that this is complex. There are many different challenges in tracking, depending on the type of COVID funding and spend. But we are continuing to look at how we can improve it.
Okay. Mr. Marsh, just looking at the overall levels of public expenditure in Scotland at the moment, so including non-COVID monies, we're seeing record amounts of money and perhaps more complex arrangements than we have seen in the history of devolution. So we have record spending, we have levelling up, we have huge COVID disbursements through local authorities, we have the upcoming health and social care levy. So that is perhaps a more complex set of spending arrangements than we've ever seen since this Parliament was created. So would you therefore welcome and possibly encourage greater UK-level oversight and scrutiny of public spending within Scotland?
Well, that's a complicated question. I think, I was probably... found that question easier to answer until the last bit. So, look, I mean, we are continually building the impact of the Scottish Government in Scotland. I take Social Security as a good example. I had an excellent session yesterday with David Wallace and Social Security Scotland and the team, the financial outturn there now building as we take over adult disability payment, child payments, the doubling of that, going to have a good impact on child poverty in Scotland. So under devolution, with health, with education, we are seeing our capacity to make an impact grow year by year by year. Clearly, in that time, the pandemic has radically changed that dynamic. As we said, the significant in-year consequentials in these accounts, and again this year, we expect it to be less in the year ahead. We have very close relationships with HM Treasury. There is an almost constant dialogue going on around Barnett consequentials. Alison, who is also online, can say a bit about the fiscal framework review and the conversation that is happening there between Ms. Forbes and the Chief Secretary around the long-term fiscal framework for Scotland. But to answer your question directly, I don't think there is an appetite in the Scottish Government for an increased level of oversight of our devolved powers and budget responsibilities from the UK government. We don't think that would be a necessary thing. But we absolutely work in partnership, and we've seen some good collaboration, for example, on green freeports, which has been a helpful investment, an additional sort of £52 million for Scotland for two ports, that process announced recently, and on levelling up, good conversations, of course, going on with the Department for Levelling Up between the First Minister, Ms Forbes, and Mr Gove, as we agree what the Shared Prosperity Fund will mean, what levelling up will mean, and how our local communities can take advantage of it. So rather than it being oversight of one versus another, my interest is in creating the environment for the teams to work in partnership and try and make sure whatever we do, we always try and get the best outcomes for Scotland. But Alison could say a bit more about the fiscal framework review, if that's helpful, because that is part of the next step of what the fiscal powers could look and be like in the future.
So happy to come in, convener.
Yes, please come in. We'd welcome your contribution.
Okay. Thank you very much. So as the Permanent Secretary says, the fiscal framework and the review of that is something that's particularly active for us at the moment. Scotland actually has been going, and I understand Mr. Hoy's question, there's a lot of complexity. Actually, it's a complexity that we've been handling over a number of years, because we have been going through some of the fastest, deepest devolution of any fiscal powers of any country in the OECD. So we've been creating that fiscal institutional landscape as well, the first tax legislation for 300 years, establishing Revenue Scotland, having the Scottish Fiscal Commission to actually generate the forecasts of what we build into our budget so that they are robust. And the fiscal framework means we are actually already operating in one of the most heavily regulated environments. That fiscal framework, though, is right and proper that it's due for review. So the Scottish Government with the Treasury have jointly agreed to commission an independent report on the block grant adjustment arrangements, and obviously looking for stakeholder input in that as well, prior to a broader review of the fiscal framework itself. So I think, you know, this is timely. We've taken on and really taken forward the powers that have already come forward here in Scotland. And I think this comprehensive consideration of the operation of the current framework to ensure that the Scottish Government and the Parliament actually has the necessary powers now to manage the risks and the opportunities we face within our devolved responsibilities and to support the ongoing economic recovery, so vital after the impact of COVID, is really essential. So we work really closely with the Finance Committee in Parliament on this as well, and we're making some really considerable progress with Treasury colleagues. The Cabinet Secretary met with the Chief Secretary at a meeting of the Joint Exchequer on the 3rd of February, discussed the scope of the view, and I think, you know, there's clearly really good steps that have been taken forward, and we're happy to keep the committee advised on that as that goes forward too. Thanks.
Thank you. If I just return just to transparency around COVID-related spending, Mr. Marks, would you like to say perhaps what plans the Scottish Government has to be more open about that and to make the clear links between the budgets, the funding arrangements and the actual spending on the ground in relation to COVID expenditure?
So I think that's something we have sought to do throughout the annual report and accounts. So for each portfolio, the CABSEC and Director Generals being clear on the inputs in terms of financial spend and the budget, the outputs in terms of activity and the outcomes. So I see that, I observe it as being a good discipline in the annual report and accounts, but I hear the desire for that to be more detailed. And I think, as Jackie reflected, we want to maximise the transparency. We're here to serve Parliament, the Scottish people. We want people to have confidence that they're getting value for money from the investment. As Alison said, we continue to see the maturity of our tax system, our social security system, and as per the Audit Scotland report this morning, you know, as we emerge from the worst of this pandemic, we want to demonstrate, as per our spending review, which we hope to announce in May, that we have the right strategic plans for the Parliament, multi-year, that will deliver you know, the right outcomes as per the framework, but is also prioritised and delivers the right results. And we'll try and make sure that's reflected in the spending review announcement and in our annual report and accounts and reporting going forwards.
You mentioned, obviously, in 2021, there were three quite significant in-year budget changes. Could you perhaps just give the committee a flavour of how those are monitored and reported, particularly in relation to those COVID-related expenditures?
So when we get an in-year change due to a consequential, a good example recently was on cost of living, you know, announcement by the Chancellor, followed very quickly by an announcement by our ministers. We make clear to Parliament how that consequential will be spent. And in cost of living, that was precisely done, and the explanation of the spend was communicated to the council tax bands, allocated through local government, and then that money will be tracked and reported against. So I think that's the discipline that should apply through our in-year budget changes when we receive consequentials. And you know, Jackie, part of our delivery executive, each week we talk about finance risk, delivery and performance, and then each month we get the refreshed outturn on spend by portfolio area, and we're able to track that quite precisely. But Jackie, do you want to say a bit more about that?
I'm really happy to. I think it's important to note that in any year, but in particular in 2021, it was quite dynamic in terms of the budget management. And of course, the COVID funding announcements weren't happening in isolation to other changes in our budgets. So in each of the three budget revision exercises, we would have been aggregating together all of those adjustments and presenting them to Parliament, because it was really important that we had taut and realistic budgets for Parliament to hold us accountable to. Of course, each of the budget revisions, there would have been a really transparent description of those budget changes. But I think therein lies some of the challenges that we were alluding to earlier. As we know, the UK government made announcements throughout the year, some of which generated consequentials. But the process of those consequentials being confirmed happens at a much later stage, so through the supplementary estimate that will happen in January or in February, as we've seen this year. Sometimes those amounts that come through are different to what perhaps we had been planning on. So there is a bit of a reconciliation. We're also subject to possibly negative consequentials on other areas. So what we get is a net figure from the UK government. And again, we have to manage that. In addition, and particularly linked to COVID, a lot of our schemes were demand-led. So whilst we would have made announcements, we would then have determined what the requirement was based on the demand for some of those schemes, and our budgets may well have been adjusted at a later stage. So what we're trying to do in thinking about how we can be transparent is manage all of those factors. But again, I come back to the point I made earlier, we're fully committed to being as transparent as we can.
Okay. And finally, just in relation to the underspend, obviously that was £580 million. Could you give the committee just some flavour of the underlying reasons for the underspend? And could you say how much of that is possibly available through the Scotland Reserve?
Yes. So we were reflecting on this week. And as I said in the opening statement, on the resource budget, you know, I was impressed by the low level of variance below 1%. But nonetheless, as you say, the capital underspend with, you know, the total underspend of 580 million less, which was 1.1% of the 50 billion baseline. I mean, in terms of the breakdown there, you know, 320 million of it related to transport infrastructure and connectivity investments. And as was true, you know, down south and in countries and economies around the world, lockdowns had a significant impact on the capacity of capital projects to stick to timetables that had been set pre-pandemic. And that was the main challenge there. We also did, as Jackie said, receive a late consequential, which we were able to then carry forward. So I think the reassuring elements of the flexibility in the fiscal framework, as Alison described, is we were able to carry forward all of that underspend to make sure that the pounds were not lost to ultimately the Scottish people, and we can make sure that money is still invested. But nonetheless, these in-year movements in budget and the accounting challenge that presents for the team is complicated, which hence the fiscal framework review and the importance actually of having that partnership dialogue with the UK government upstream to understand their own planning on initiatives that are coming down the track, so we're able to also plan in partnership, ready for when we are going to receive new monies. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to invite Sharon Dowie to ask a couple more questions.
Okay, thank you. Looking particularly at paragraphs 43 and 44, says the Scottish Government should clearly outline its plans for future investment in private companies to ensure that there is greater transparency over financial support provided and the value of public funds committed. The Scottish Government has committed to develop a framework to outline its principles and approach for decisions about future investment in private companies. So can you tell me when this framework will be published?
Yeah, so the intention is to publish it at the end of March. We are just finalising the framework based on inputs and advice, which has been really appreciated from Audit Scotland. So we'll now put that to our ministers with the intent to publish end of March. I reviewed the framework with the team, with Colin and the team this week, and I think it's a helpful addition, and it, you know, builds on the conversations we had around Lochaber, around Prestwick. And from my perspective, if I think about the year ahead, as I say, I want to get out and about, get to meet the executives of those teams, and your chief executive of Ferguson's just in place, understand their asset position now, the level of risk and their future plans. And the framework seeks to build on our existing guidance, take the lessons from those investments and make sure that we continue to refine the framework accordingly, and that works well. It breaks it down into terms of what the right principles are, what the right accounting officer tests are, and then what the key considerations should be. And I think it does relate to the point that was asked earlier around the counterfactual, the business case, you know, a last resort investment choice, but then also what our long-term strategic intent is to realise value for money. So it is all set out in there, and intent is to get that published end of March. Yeah.
Okay. I'm a bit worried about the word intent. Intent to publish at the end of March doesn't mean it will be published at the end of March.
Yeah, and the only reason I say that is it is getting finalised. We'll share the advice with ministers. It may mean that somebody wants to refine it further, but from my perspective, I think that is feasible end of March. Yeah.
And just a further one on that one. I know you've just started in January, you'd said, but the initial report said that the recommendation was put in 2018. So why do you think it's taken so long for the framework to be published, intent to purchase, publish at the end of March?
Well, I'm not sure I can take any credit for starting in January and getting it published in March. But, I mean, Colin, do you want to... I mean, well, the bottom line, I think, is the pandemic, as colleagues will appreciate, has hugely disrupted everything. And I saw that even in my handover with my predecessor, and then certainly from the 5th of January, people working flat out all night, weekends, to manage the Omicron peak and to manage our response. And it has been an unprecedented disruption to everything, as it has to everyone's personal lives and society. And I think that included this framework. But Colin?
Yes, all I would add is that we have always followed the guidance that's in the Scottish Public Finance Manual. And this is an iteration of that guidance, and we'll continue to develop new iterations of what is now considered a framework as we go forward. And we've been working with Audit Scotland on this, certainly over the last year. We had really useful meetings with them in September and November, and I think we're now in a position where we have a new framework which we can recommend is published, and I'm pretty confident it will happen. But we've always followed the SPFM. We will continue to follow that, and we'll continue to build on it.
Thank you. I think what would be really helpful if this, obviously Audit Scotland do the audits, and one of the things we've found is that the recommendations don't seem to happen very quickly. So that recommendation came in 2018, and I know we've had the pandemic, but we didn't have the pandemic in 2018 or 2019. So I think what would help Audit Scotland is when the auditors do their audits, if we maybe have a wee bit more of a timely trying to action the recommendations. Can I just ask another one as well on whether the principles are being applied in current decision-making processes? I think I'm probably thinking about ScotRail in that one, so and are the principles being applied in current decision-making processes within the Scottish Government?
Yes. As I said, we have always followed the principles in the SPFM. The framework represents an improvement and iteration of those principles, and we'll continue to follow them. So, as the Permanent Secretary said, the overarching principles about there being a clear policy rationale, about there being a commercial outcome, about there being a comprehensive business case. And one of the things the framework now does is give more information and more detail and more specificity about what should be in that comprehensive business case. But yes, when we make decisions about investments in business, we will and do follow the principles that are described in the SPFM and in this framework.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Permanent Secretary, and we can't hold you individually accountable for this either, but one of the other things which this committee has been waiting a long time for, and the Auditor General and the Auditor General's predecessor has been waiting a long time for, our whole public sector consolidated accounts to be published. And we have an understanding that this is going to be produced in two stages. And I think stage one is due to be published in spring of this year, spring 2022. Could you just perhaps bring the committee up to date on what progress is being made, and do you expect that target date to be met?
Yeah, and I mean, and just on the point previously, you know, I've had really good introductory meetings with Stephen and with Audit Scotland, and I am completely committed to ensuring when we get the recommendations, we're clear on them. We have a good debate about them if we have a challenge, and then we get on with it. So I think it's a fair challenge for us, and let's make sure we get that right. I think on this one, on public sector accounts, Jackie is our resident expert and can say a bit more, but plan has been developed with Audit Scotland, as you say, convener, for a staged approach. I was challenging the team to say, explain to me what that means. And my understanding is that is going to enable us to see a wider set of expenditure that relates to Scotland's overall public administration, so things like Audit Scotland itself, the Scottish Parliament, non-ministerial public bodies, and the like. So bringing that together so that it is more visible, and then the aim is for that to be delivered in the spring, and then from there going into the summer, developing what the wider output could be. I think the only bit of caution I bring to this is making sure that it is indeed going to add value and isn't going to create significant additional burdens collecting data on, for example, the NHS or local government or others. So I just want to be confident that we're doing this with the right intent, because it is going to help with regards to transparency, with regards the tracking of overall spend and our understanding of value for money in Scotland. But Jackie can say a bit more about the timetable and certainty for you there.
Well, is a cast iron guarantee it's going to happen, or are you now caveating that? I mean, the other thing I'm bound to say to you is your predecessor sat before this committee or its equivalent in 2016 and gave an undertaking to provide whole public sector Scottish Government consolidated accounts, and we're still waiting in 2022.
So I think, I guess the thing I would ask is I reserve a bit of judgment to provide the committee and our ministers with advice on doing it in a way that is actually proportionate, will add value, and can be done without creating significant additional administrative burdens on other public bodies. Having said all of that, our absolute intent is to first get the stage one done and then move to a stage two that does fulfil that commitment, but as I say, does it in a proportionate way or in a way that does indeed add value. But Jackie, do you want to say a bit more about that? Because you're our
very
expert.
Happy to. And just to build on the Permanent Secretary there, we remain committed to producing this. In taking a staged approach, it allows us to share it with Audit Scotland and the committee, get feedback and evolve it in a way that, as the Permanent Secretary has set out, it is meaningful and adds value. In terms of the time, we are on track to deliver the stage one in spring. We'll be sharing that draft with Audit Scotland very shortly. And we are intending to undertake stage two in the summer. Again, my caveat around that is the point that the Permanent Secretary raised about not creating an additional burden. We are planning to use data and information capture that is already happening with respect to the UK government whole of government accounts. So we wouldn't be asking entities to do something that they're not doing already. But we are aware at the moment that the 2021 whole of government accounts from the UK government perspective isn't live, isn't open. So that may inhibit us as we get nearer the time, but we'll keep an eye on that. But the intent is absolutely there. The work is being undertaken. If I may, and the 2016 recommendation precedes me, I'm afraid too, but I do have to point to the pandemic in a slightly different way. Because this is a consolidated set of accounts, we have to have the underlying accounts prepared and completed. And unfortunately, the elongated timelines for those accounts being completed have impacted on the timeline and the ability for us to do the whole of public sector accounts. Even with a timeline of the end of September for the consolidated accounts of the Scottish Government, it would be challenging. But we're currently working to the end of December, and that just runs us straight into the next year end and the next accounting period. But we are very confident with the staged approach that we've set out, and we would welcome the feedback from the committee in due course on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I'm sure that we will reflect on the evidence that you've given us on that subject this morning, and we'll decide on what we think the next steps that we need to take are. I just want to take you back, and Permanent Secretary, you've mentioned the National Performance Framework a few times this morning in your evidence. Could you tell us what plans you have to improve performance reporting in the consolidated accounts?
Yes, as you say, alluded to it earlier, Convener. I think the National Performance Framework is something that is particularly powerful in Scotland. It's something that is respected elsewhere and is best practice. It is powerful that it works for public bodies, agencies, local governments, and is transparent. The evidence is clear, and that creates a good set of strategic accountability. And that is integrated, as you know, into the annual report and accounts, each portfolio area directors clear what their activities relate to with regards to the achievement of those outcomes. The thing that I want to work on, which the teams are already doing, but we want to make progress with, the point we made earlier, is this short to medium term indicators to track activity against outcomes so we can see progress. And as and when it's feasible for us to include more of that into the annual report and accounts as it's developed, I'll absolutely be encouraging the teams to do so, yeah.
Right, thank you very much. There was just one other area which is quite specific, which I wanted to ask you about, which was at the last session on the 27th of January, we took evidence from the Auditor General on the overspend in the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, which was the result of special payments of £40.2 million being given out in connection with the acquisition and administration of Rangers Football Club. I guess what we are interested in is not only the impact that has on the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, I think we're also interested in the decision-making around that, particularly in the realm of the role of the Lord Advocate, for example. So I don't know whether whether the overspend as a result of the payouts, and I think there are still two outstanding payouts outstanding cases, I should say, we were told about at the last session on this. We were told in the audit report, we are told in the audit report, that the Scottish Government authorised the overspend. Could you tell me who it was that authorised that overspend?
Jackie, do you know off the top of your head? I mean, we can check to give you certainty, I think is probably the best thing for us to do. Ultimately, in terms of the signing off of the annual report and accounts in terms of any overspend, it is signed off by the accounting officer, the principal accounting officer, and by ministers. But if there's a specific that you're alluding to, we can take that away if we can't say now. But Jackie, anything you want to add on that?
So in the first instance, the accountable officer, in terms of their budget, would be having a conversation with the Crown Office and in particular looking at the extent to which it could manage the pressure within its budget. And then where it was clear that it would go above that, then again, the accountable officer would be putting advice to ministers and the cabinet essentially would be signing off on budget changes.
So, I mean, you know, just checking the detail here, you know, financial year 2021, as you say, Crown Office procure to fiscal service charged £27.9 million to the accounts, including a provision for £14.96 million. So, but as Jackie said, you know, that goes through the usual due diligence with regards accounting officer and then ministerial approval. But happy to come back to the committee with some more detail on that, if helpful.
Yeah, I think it would be. I mean, I know that there are other processes underway, but I do think there is an important aspect to this for this Public Audit Committee, which is about you know, how the decision-making process was arrived at. You know, and the Lord Advocate admitted liability in court, which then therefore would have had financial consequences. So if you could get back to us on that, I think that would be very, very helpful. I'm going to move it on now and ask Colin Beattie to come in with a series of questions. Colin.
Thank you, Mira. Firstly, I'd like to go back to the intervention I made earlier on about the smelter, just for a clarification in my own mind. You're relying on a 2019 book value to cover the Scottish Government's potential liability. Now, book value is certainly not necessarily market value, and it's certainly not for sale value. Now, normally, as a matter of prudence, and if the Scottish Government is in the position of a lender, then, if you like, a guarantor, then it would be looking at for sale value to ensure that in a worst case, you'd be covered. Has that for sale value been calculated? And if so, does it still cover the potential liability of the Scottish Government?
Colin?
I'm not aware of us having calculated the value in the way you described. I will check that and I will come back to the committee if we have, and I'll also come back to the committee with any plans that we can put in place to do exactly what you've just described.
Clearly the issue is that book value and indeed to an extent market value will assume the smelter as a going concern and it will be valued accordingly, whereas the for sale value will simply be the value of the land and buildings without the business attached, if you like. And that is the critical one to ensure that we do have cover. Let me move on. We'll obviously, I'm sure the committee will be... Oh, sorry.
One extra bit, if that's OK. Yeah.
Could I just make one clarification, if that's OK? So the number that Colin was referring to earlier is the estimate of the value of the security. That isn't directly linked to the number that's reflected in the balance sheet, in the accounts, which is the expected credit loss against the guarantee. So they are very different numbers, just to clarify.
OK, I was taking it, the book value as being the book value. You're saying there's a bit more behind it. But nevertheless, the important thing is the for sale value to ensure that we have that cover.
Yeah, and I think, you know, as I said earlier, with regards to all of these investments, my plan through the year is to visit each of them, do that review, and as you say, I think we should include, of course, the asset position and then the longer term plan. And I want to discuss that with each of those executives and their boards, meet the team in the community and properly get under the detail of each of them. And so hopefully we can have a good dialogue with the committee about each of their futures. And if individual members would like to meet to talk about those, very happy to do so.
There will be an appetite for that when the time comes. Let me move on a little bit to particularly COVID-19 expenditure and the fraud and irregularities around that. Obviously, the two big business support schemes total practically 1.6 billion. And they responded very quickly to COVID-19. And, you know, quick responses, obviously, there was a need to get money to the right place at the right time very quickly, which, you know, opens up a higher risk element. Now, I notice that the Scottish Government estimates that fraud and error will be 1-2% of these payments, and that approximately 16 to 32 million would be involved in that. And I'm wondering how that equates to the figures that we're seeing in Westminster, obviously on a bigger scale, where we're seeing estimates of anything up to 15 billion and above. Have we been better at it? Is it simply, I don't know. It seems there should be, given that Westminster's had that experience, why are we better? Why is it not as high here proportionally?
Yeah, so look, it's a really fair and a fair question. So I think your description of the provision on fraud is precisely right. So 1-2%, which was based on the benchmarking from previous schemes and the range of financial risk at that 16 to 32 million. Colin will be able to say a little bit more about our process then of assuring the outturn. But an early reflection from my perspective is that it looks like we're at the lower end of that, potentially even so far identified fraud, less than a million of actual cases. But I think to address your point, it was a good fast response, but it was also done in partnership with local government using existing capabilities and footprints where we had a authenticated identity for people who would be in receipt of these monies, and were using existing systems. I mean, of course, Scotland did benefit from things like the furlough scheme and from the trust and protect approach taken to universal credit. But those schemes at that scale, as you say, had their own particular design and have had a fraud loss. But because we were able to do this with local government using existing infrastructure and their expertise in delivery, we think we've kept the exposure on those grants to, so far, identified cases less than a million. But Colin, do you want to say a bit more on that?
Yes, I think throughout this pandemic, we've responded in a way that has taken into account the need to be as tight as possible and to make sure that we minimise the risk of fraud. So when we started, the initial judgments were taken about, you know, the key pivotal enterprises that we needed to support, and we worked with Scottish Enterprise and Visit Scotland and organisations like that that had established relationships, and of course that minimises the risk of fraud. We then moved on, as the Permanent Secretary said, to the provision of a much wider range of grants, much smaller grants, largely working through local authorities, leading eventually to the Strategic Framework Business Fund. And these were based on non-domestic rates. So around non-domestic rates, the local authorities already have a system in place. They have a mechanism for identifying, they have a mechanism for tying a business to a particular property, and they have a very well-tried and tested mechanism for reducing error and fraud, which they were able to bring to bear, and I think has been absolutely critical, as the Permanent Secretary said, in terms of minimising the fraud. We also then, as we moved into other areas, took decisions on a case-by-case basis. So if you look at something like the taxi fund, that was administered by local authorities. Why? Because local authorities license taxis, and therefore they have an established relationship with that organisation. We used a different approach when it came to something like the mobile close contact services. And then moving beyond that, now I know this stretches out of the financial year that we're looking at today, but we've continued to evolve that approach, and Scottish Government's appointed a head of counter fraud, and he's looked at the funds that we operate and has assessed them as adequate. We put in place now a control fraud checklist so that when people are designing schemes, when policy people are thinking about new support schemes, they can work through from the beginning and design fraud control in from the very beginning, with based upon our latest expertise and the intelligence we've picked up over the last few years.
I'm still worrying a wee bit about the differences north and south of the border. Is it very different the way that we approached it up here as opposed to down south? Did they not use the local authorities and so on as an obvious avenue to manage a great deal of the COVID-19 payments? I'm just worried that there's someplace a hidden amount that's going to jump out at us here.
I don't think I can, and I wouldn't want to put myself in the position of trying to speculate on the decisions that were taken by UK government. We focused on the approach for Scotland. We believed that working with local authorities was the best way to do that, and I believe that the evidence so far seems to suggest that that was the right thing to do, and that local authorities and the existing systems that they have and the intelligence and the people working on the ground in those areas has been of great benefit to the Scottish economy.
I'm very pleased if we have managed to keep fraud down to this sort of level. Just a niggling worry, that's all. Now, the next question you partially answered, I think, Colin. You talked about control fraud checklists and so on, check sheets. I was going to ask you about the action the Scottish Government had taken to reduce and manage the error and fraud, and maybe you could give us a little bit more detail on that.
Yes, I mean, as I said, we have appointed, or the Scottish Government more generally has appointed, head of counter fraud. He's assessed the funds, as I said, and he's worked with local authorities, looked at our controls on the business side, and found them to be adequate. And yes, the counter fraud checklist that I mentioned does allow us to bake in that learning into the assessment of future funds. So it's prompts like, you know, how do you check that a business is claiming to be in a sector that it actually is in? These are the kind of things that lead to fraud. There would be cases of people potentially applying more than once for a particular grant using a different bank account. These are all things. It goes as far as organised crime groups, impersonating genuine businesses. So what I think has been important is that we've, you know, in working with our head of counter fraud, in working with Audit Scotland, we raise those and we make policymakers and people who are deciding upon the shape and the way in which a fund operates aware of those up front so that we can plan for them.
Just adding to that, how much has the Scottish Government actually recovered in terms of fraudulent payments and payments made in error? Do we have a figure for that?
We don't actually have a figure for it because it's for the individual delivery partners to determine how and when they take legal action to recover that. So as a result, we don't have data on the number of cases of suspected fraud that they're currently pursuing. Mind you, there is, and I think to add to that degree of confidence that you were looking for earlier, Mr. Beattie, I think there is clear data to indicate that there's a high rate of prepayment fraud detection in local authorities, and that the ratio of applications to awards is low. So there's a high number of rejected applications, which suggests that the system is working extremely effectively.
Yeah, I'm a bit concerned that we don't seem to have a grip of what the recoveries are. I think that's quite important. I mean, you're making estimates of how much the fraud and errors would be, but you've no idea on recoveries. I mean, I would have thought it's a simple matter of pulling the councils and getting the figures from there.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I think it's one of those we're happy to take it away, as you say, for cases that have been identified. If I take a case that related to us, then, as you say, we would seek recovery either legally or through civil case, and our delivery partners would be doing that. But why don't we take away the challenge of can we go and look to confirm that of that million, it's just under a million, of identified fraud cases to date, how many are being pursued and how much money has been collected so far?
I mean, how much reassurance can you give us that your partners are actually vigorously pursuing that if you're not actually apparently looking at it?
Well, I can give you an assurance that we're continuing to work with those local delivery partners, and we are continuing to work with them to ensure that they do have the resources available in order to pursue those actions should they choose to do so.
how effective it is.
We
need to know the outcomes, surely.
As the Permanent Secretary says, I'm sure there's action that we can take to improve our data collection and to return to the committee if and when that happens.
Yeah, I mean, that's a logical extension. Also, is a question of about you're making all these estimates. Until you know the whole picture, you can't know that these estimates are particularly accurate.
I think it's a different thing. So we're confirming cases of fraud that have indeed been identified as confirmed to us. You're making a fair point to say how much of that money has then been recovered. And we'll take the action to confirm that back to you.
So local authorities are confirming to you the number of cases and so on. What you don't have is what they're doing about it, in actual fact. You say they're pursuing them vigorously, but you've no actual evidence to show that.
Well, as we were suggesting, I mean, I think we can do more to collect and collate information, but there is a lot of ongoing work between the team in the Scottish Government that's responsible, and we have a dedicated team, a dedicated directorate and division focused on this action, and our local authority delivery partners. And there is no current information, there's no information that suggests that there's large amounts of undetected fraud and no other factors really that are introducing any significant uncertainty into this. But we will continue to work with them and we will look to see what we can do to improve the flow of information and intelligence back.
Data is always king. It's always a problem getting it and in the right format and so forth. It's a problem that comes before this committee all the time. This doesn't seem difficult to get. And, you know, I would have hoped that the government would have plans to report fraud and error and the amounts recovered. I mean, it seems pretty basic to me. Just really a final winding up question is, what lessons have we learned in all this in terms of fraud and error and the processes that have been put in place? Have we learned anything from this?
Well, I think you made the point in your opening question. The money got out the door quickly, got to the right sectors and delivered the support that was needed at a critical time. That was not without challenge, of course, and a lot of heavy lifting, and local government has played a huge part in making that happen. On the fraud and error point, I completely agree with your challenge of show us the data on recovery against the identified cases to date. But nonetheless, that exposure at 1-2% in the provision in accounts and the actual to date is quite encouraging given the volume of investment and the context of which it was done. Because as you say, it had to be done at pace given the crisis. So, and also some of the comparators elsewhere. But I think we have certainly learned important lessons around making sure we tailor these schemes. As you say, data is key in terms of not just tracking the spend, but its receipt. And of course, there's been a debate about that. And yeah, we're happy to come back to the committee in the future also and just talk more about generally the learning from COVID as the strategic framework hopefully embeds and we move on a bit.
Certainly, I think this committee would be interested in a bit more data around the, what has happened in terms of recoveries and so on. Yeah. Because, you know, I still look at these big figures south of the border and it sort of niggles that, are we missing something?
Yeah. And I think, you know, it's a fair challenge that we'll take back to the team and ask them to just think again on the due diligence, on the assurance levels, on the sampling. Are we confident?
Yeah, and I think a critical element of that will be local authorities themselves and the publication of their own accounts, which you would expect them to publish numbers of frauds, for example, in the schemes that they've administered as part of that process. So that will give us an opportunity to do so.
Thank you. Thanks very much indeed. We're coming towards the last lap, Permanent Secretary. But I'm going to invite Sharon Dowie, who's got a couple of questions to put to you before we finish, and then Willie Coffey is coming back in.
Thank you. During 2021, the Scottish Government commissioned an external consultant to conduct a review of the Scottish Government's relationships with public bodies. It considered the current delivery of sponsorship arrangements within the Scottish Government, including how it should organise and manage its relationships with public bodies, It also considered how sponsors and public bodies can effectively manage risk and, very importantly, escalation of issues when challenges arise. So could you tell us what improvements have been advised by the consultant and if all the findings were accepted by the Scottish Government?
No, I'm happy to. So I think that this is a really important piece of work. I'm very conscious that, as we were talking about earlier, you know, the footprint of the public sector in Scotland in terms of public sector accounts and capturing that, and then the leadership and sponsorship of those public bodies is critical. I've been able to meet so far, you know, Social Security Scotland, Food Standards Scotland, Transport Scotland, Scottish Prison Service, Education Scotland, Revenue Scotland, and many more still to come. And the intent, of course, is to make sure we've got the very best sponsorship arrangements in place. We have had receipt of that report. We've got all the recommendations. I think it's fair to say that we do accept that they are all helpful. The next step from my perspective is a session that I'm bringing together with my whole executive team to walk through each of those recommendations and talk about the assurance process that we will each step through within each of the DG portfolios to confirm that those recommendations are in place. So, you know, making sure responsibilities and roles are clear, that a full business case is in place before a new public body is established, that where it's a smaller public body, we seek to use shared services to avoid duplication, that we have well-developed performance frameworks, the ministers are meeting the chair, chief executive on a regular basis. These are some of the recommendations that we've had. I think, you know, from my early meetings, it's clear that best practice is in place. We've got some great public bodies in Scotland and the relationship's very good. But it's consistency that matters, and we want to give that assurance back. So we'll have that focus session, get the assurance in, and then hopefully can confirm later to the committee that has indeed been established and that best practice is working well.
Is there a copy of that report available?
Yes, it's going to be published at the end of February. So right. There is
so
one,
we'll and we can get it.
We can get
then.
Yeah, and get a copy to the committee. Yeah.
Yeah. You've kind of explained there how you're taking forward the recommendations. So the one thing I would ask is to make sure that there's timescales in them. So there's a timescale so that we know when they'll be implemented, so that we don't end up getting a report 100%. Further down the line.
And that's the objective of the ET session from my perspective. So, you know, for me to feel confident in that principal accounting officer role. As you say, I want to know these recommendations are embedded and consistent. So as you say, my expectation is that through this calendar year, all of them would be established as best practice and assured back to me from each DG. So, you know, as a sort of window of time for us to get that done and assured properly, that would be a sort of broad time planning assumption. But we can make sure if there's a complex recommendation or two that we need to have a specific milestone on, we can put one in place. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Well, for the final question or two, I'm going to hand over to Willie Coffey. Willie, come back in.
Thanks again, Convener. I wonder, Permanent Secretary, if I could ask a question on the European Structural and Investment Funds issue that is also contained within the Auditor General's report. We know that the UK government committed to replacing those funds that previously came from the European Union, and the estimate of those funds is £183 million a year coming to Scotland. Firstly, would you know if that sum has been confirmed yet? And secondly, and importantly for this committee, what's this committee or this Parliament or Audit Scotland's role to be in scrutinising and holding that spend to account in Scotland? We previously did it, but as far as I know, none of us are aware where the scrutiny function will lie as we move forward. It may fall into shared prosperity, levelling up and so on and so forth. But as yet, we don't know. We're not aware if there's a role even for the Scottish Parliament to scrutinise the spend that we previously had. So we'd be obliged if you could clarify any of those matters for the committee.
Yeah, so I think on your last point, this is one of the complexities of the UKIM legislation and common frameworks. And as you say, with the Shared Prosperity Fund and precisely how it will work into Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales. My ambition is that, going back to the conversation we had earlier around partnership, that we manage to settle on a co-design, co-delivery type model where we're able to ensure that the Shared Prosperity Fund investments and levelling up into Scotland aligns with our existing programmes, so we don't have duplication, is coordinated so that it works well for communities and partners on the ground and is optimised to deliver best value. But we don't have that agreed detail yet. We are having very clear conversations at senior ministerial level about it. And there is still that opportunity to get to that co-design, co-delivery position so that we do have coordination and optimise it. If we can get to that, then I think there is a role for the committee with regards to how we as a Scottish Government are engaging with that and the committee's oversight of our involvement. So we can absolutely keep the committee up to date as Shared Prosperity and Levelling Up finalises. In terms of the accounts, there is a small write-off and provision in respect to European structural funding already expended that will not or may not be reimbursed by the European Commission to the Scottish Government. And it was 16 million write-off, 28.7 million provision, which Colin can say a bit more on the detail of, but you know, we've stepped through, we think, the right accounting process to make that transparent.
Is the Scottish Government making it clear to our UK government colleagues that that scrutiny function must remain in Scotland where it previously was? Are we making it clear that that's our wish?
You can rest assured 100% that that has been made very, very clear, very consistently.
Has there been every level. Response to that yet?
There are regular dialogues going on that have yet to conclude.
Mr. Gove is down the stairs at the minute. Could we invite him in to give that a clarification?
I think there is a shared ambition around what the Shared Prosperity Fund and Levelling Up should seek to ultimately achieve. You know, reduce poverty, improve skills, prosperity. The question, as you say, is the how. Oversight matters. And from a Scottish Government perspective, clearly we would prefer to be able to direct that investment and align it with our existing strategies and plans in partnership with local government in Scotland. I don't think that is how it is going to work. So the question is, can we resolve a co-design, co-delivery operating model that ensures that we get the best possible partnership working to get the best value for money?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Willie. And just to conclude, Permanent Secretary, I think you undertook to give us some more information in writing, whether it was about fraud, payment and recovery and decision-making in relation to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, overspend and so on. I think that would be helpful. There may be other areas that that when we go back and survey the official report, we will also follow up with you too. So can I thank you very much indeed for your time this morning and for your thoughtful contributions. Can I also thank the team that's accompanied you, Leslie Fraser and Alison Stafford, who've joined us online this morning. Thanks very much to you, and to Jackie McAllister and Colin Cook, who've joined us in the committee room this morning. So with that, I would like to suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Well, could I resume this morning's meeting of the Public Audit Committee and turn to agenda item 3, which is a review of the Section 22 report arising from the 2020-21 audit of the organisation Scottish Canals. Can I welcome our witnesses for this part of the meeting? Auditor General Stephen Boyle joins us in the committee room. Welcome. And online we've got Graeme Greenhill, who's a Senior Manager Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland. And we're also joined by Joanne Brown, who's a partner with Grant Thornton, who I think carried out the audit on the ground with Scottish Canals. But Auditor General, if I could begin by inviting you to give us an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I've prepared this report under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000 to draw the Parliament's attention to challenges that Scottish Canals have had in valuing their assets in 2020-2021 and the resultant disclaimer of opinion issued by their external auditors. By way of background, on the 1st of April 2020, Scottish Canals' status changed from a public corporation to a non-departmental public body. That change came with a requirement to follow HM Treasury's accounting guide, including the methodology to be used to value the canal infrastructure and inland waterways. Although the required valuations for investment properties and land and buildings were conducted, auditors found that Scottish Canals did not get valuations for around £51 million of specialist assets. These included dredging equipment, lock gates and canal basin widening works. A subsequent valuation aimed at estimating the cost of replacing these assets in their current condition and existing use then raised concerns about the accuracy of Scottish Canal's fixed assets register, amongst other valuation flaws. This meant auditors had to issue a disclaimer of opinion on the accuracy of Scottish Canal's financial statements because insufficient audit evidence was available to conclude on the overall valuation of the canal infrastructure and inland waterways. Convener, again, this remains a very unusual step for an auditor to take. Scottish Canals will now undertake a new valuation process of the canal infrastructure estate in its entirety during 2022. A key part of this work will require Scottish Canals to review its fixed asset register to ensure that all assets are appropriately recorded and categorised. This will be a substantial piece of work, but necessary to provide sufficient evidence to support future judgments and estimates of asset valuations. It's also needed to support preparation of Canals' medium-term financial strategy and the delivery of its asset management strategy. Scottish Canals Board now needs to assure itself that the organisation has sufficient skills and capacity to deliver this complex project and that it provides appropriate support and challenge to ensure it is delivered to plan. As you know, Convener, I'm joined this morning by Joanne Brown, the partner and external auditor of Scottish Canals from Grant Thornton, and also from Graeme Greenhill, who's one of our senior managers in Audit Scotland. And between the three of us, we'll look to answer the committee's questions.
Thanks, Auditor General. And as usual, please feel free to call on Joanne and Graeme as appropriate. And to Joanne and Graeme, if you do wish to come in at any point, if you just use the chat box function and put an R in there, and we'll ensure that you are called. I want to begin by asking Sharon Dowie to ask the first question. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Page 3 of the report states, Scottish Canals consists of a board comprising a chair, vice-chair and between 1 and 4 members appointed by the Scottish Ministers. As such, it operates on a day-to-day basis independently from the Scottish Government, but for which Scottish Ministers are ultimately accountable to the Scottish Parliament. Scottish Canals Chief Executive and accountable officer for the organisation is also personally accountable to the Scottish Parliament for ensuring its resources are used economically, efficiently and effectively. Can you tell us what support, if any, was provided by the Scottish Government to the Board of Scottish Canals when the status of the organisation was changed from a public corporation to a non-departmental public body, and whether or not it was the level of support that you would have expected?
Yeah, good morning, Deputy Convener. The point you make, actually, in terms of the overall accountability is clear for this, that the accountability for preparing a set of annual report and accounts rests with the organisation and the accountable officer. As you know, through the Scottish Public Finance Manual, sets out the personal accountability through to this committee of the Scottish Parliament. Before I maybe turn to Joanne, maybe say a bit more about some of the conversations that have taken place between the Scottish Government sponsoring team and Scottish Canals, and to set that out for the committee. But this, if it's helpful, first of all, to say this, it wasn't sprung upon Scottish Canals that this would be a new requirement. So look at some of the chronology. As Grant Thornton, in their annual audit report on the audit concluding 2019, noted that this change of status was pending, that the decision stems from a decision made by the Office for National Statistics, having reviewed the functions, operation and status of Scottish Canals, that it deemed it be more adequately described as a non-departmental public body as opposed to a public corporation. So going back for nearly 2 years, that project and that awareness was there. As I say, Deputy Vina, the responsibility rests with the accountable officer and the board of Scottish Canals to reflect that in their accounts. But there always is interaction, as you would anticipate, with the sponsoring body. And I maybe just turn to Joanne if there's anything more that she wishes to say about how those conversations ensued.
Joanne, do you want to come in?
Thanks. Apologies, I was stuck on mute there. Just to add to that point, representation from the sponsor team, Transport Scotland, does attend routinely the Scottish Canals board in a representative manner. And the board did discuss on a number of occasions the change in status to an NDPB. When the change was first announced, which I think was round about September 19, there were a number of discussions, as I understand it, that did take place with the sponsor team. And laterally, as the audit matters arose during the audit later on last year, there were further conversations with the Transport Scotland in their sponsor role at that stage.
So was it lack of understanding from the board, or was it not enough guidance from the Scottish Government, or... Because if they knew that it was going to happen in 2019 and they haven't taken any action.
So from an external audit perspective, it was known, obviously, the change to the NDPB would require a change in the accounting and the way that they accounted under the frame. We had a number of discussions with Scottish Canals management, and we also shared a paper later on to management outlining some of those issues that they would need to consider in changing to the frame. In terms of the specialist 51 million of assets, I think there was a lack of understanding from Scottish Canals on the need to get those valued in order to comply with the frame. So when they were picking up the changes to the frame, this balance was missed effectively.
Okay, thank you.
And just to clarify, I think FREM is the Her Majesty's Treasury Financial Reporting Manual, isn't it? Yeah, just so we're all clear about that. Right, I'm going to turn to Craig Hoy, who's got a question to put.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Bond. Thank you for joining us for what I understand is a busy morning. Just really a point of clarification, really, in relation to financial performance 2021. Your report provides information on Scottish Canals' financial performance for that period. However, it's not absolutely clear from the report whether you have any specific concerns about Scottish Canals' financial performance, or if the information that you set out in the report is to help provide broader context to the overall situation. So could you just clarify your position in that regard?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Hoy. It's largely the latter rather than the former. So we look to, in preparing a Section 22 report, so the principal objective of this is to draw the Parliament's attention to the challenges Scottish Canals have had in valuing their specialist infrastructure assets, and the resultant disclaimer of opinion, which touched on in the opening statement, is a very unusual move and an important steps that Scottish Canals needs to take in the current financial year to resolve that matter. Nonetheless, we do draw attention to the overall financial position of Scottish Canals, and as the report touches on, the need for it to develop a medium-term financial strategy. The nature of Scottish Canals' activity is managing Scotland's inland waterways. As an organisation, it has been involved in regeneration activity for many years, and that influences its income arrangements as well. So in valuing its estate, it's important that it captures what that means through to its revenue projections, its call on government grants as part of a medium-term financial strategy. So we provide that as context largely, but the matters aren't entirely unrelated.
Thank you. I'm going to turn now to Colin Beattie, who's got a couple of questions to ask. Colin.
Thank you, Mina. General, looking at the big picture, is there a governance issue here?
The principal conclusion we reached, Mr. Beattie, is that Scottish Canals needs to take some significant steps in the current year to resolve the issue that led to the disclaimer of opinion. I don't wish to labour the point, but it is a very unusual step that the auditors have taken to issue a disclaimer of opinion. And I say that recognising, as I do, that you received a report in the last couple of weeks that similarly had a disclaimer of opinion, but it's been many, many years since an auditor has taken such steps that there was insufficient evidence. We note in the report, and as I mentioned in my opening remarks, that the Board of Scottish Canals will want to assure itself that they will be able to resolve this during the current financial year. But it's also true that there were 2 years or so before these accounts were signed off that steps could have been taken. And we know that the organisation, as all others, as you've heard already this morning, have been dealing with the effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, and that there have been changes in personnel within Scottish Canals that will have interrupted its progress. But what we're saying today in the report published is that there's a real need for the Board of Scottish Canals to track and monitor and be assured on progress. Joanne might want to come in and say a bit more about the timeline for this year's audit, the signing off of the accounts, and the steps that the Board will be following over the course of the year. Joanne.
There's something that I may want to ask there. I was going to ask what the role of the external auditors was in this, because they must have been advising the Board all the way along in this. Were they ignored? Did they not give sufficient advice, guidance, clarification? Perhaps Joan can give us a bit more info on that.
I'm sure Joanna wants to say a bit more about the role that she and Grant Thornton have played. If I may, Mr. Beattie, the only thing I would say is that it's not the auditor's role to provide advice to the Board of Scottish Canals. They're providing an independent audit, and whilst all the public audit model in Scotland, as you'll know, is to provide assurance and also support public bodies to improve, but ultimately it's the responsibility of the accountable officer and the Board to ensure that their accounts are well prepared. But I think
that's true, but I'd be surprised if the external auditors didn't have a role in providing the information that the Board needed to enable them to comply with whatever was required in terms of these assets.
I accept that point, actually. I think, as Joanne mentioned and touched on, is that in the Grant Thornton external audit report on the 2018-19 audit identified that this was a significant task pending. So I think it's safe to draw a conclusion that this wasn't an event or a requirement that emerged late on during the current year, and that there have been conversations that have taken place regularly with the auditors. And as I heard Joanne say a few moments ago, that they prepared a paper on the matter. Probably best for Joanne maybe to set out, Mr. Beattie, how Grant Thornton have discussed this requirement with Scottish Canals. Joanne.
Thanks. So just to pick up on that last point before I pick up on Scottish Canals' project plan to address the issues. As the Auditor General set out in our 1920 external audit report, we highlighted a management action plan where we highlighted the risk to Scottish Canals in the transition to the accounting as an NDPB and what that would mean in terms of the significant work required in terms of restating the financial statements and there was a management response that was captured in that report. We raised it as a significant audit risk in our 2021 external audit plan, which we presented to the Audit Committee, again setting out the work that is required to restate the financial statements and the impact on the financial statements for Scottish Canals in the change of status. And as I mentioned, we then shared a paper with management, again, December 20, which set out the various accounting requirements under the FREM and where we would recommend management pay particular attention in undertaking and drafting the financial statements for the year ahead. As the Auditor General outlined, there is a lot that is, to be honest, management decision, and we are there to therefore independently audit the set of accounts and the decisions and judgments made by management. But from an external audit perspective, this is something that came up in conversation routinely with the accountable officer and the finance team throughout the year and throughout the audit work. In terms of their timeline, Scottish Canals have started to produce an indicative timeline and project plan, setting out the various activities they need to undertake during this year to resolve the issues we've reported on. And that includes updating the fixed asset register, considering the nature of the assets held, and then how those assets are going to be subject to valuation. That timeline at the moment takes them through to December of this year, and when they anticipate audited accounts being signed. That's an indicative timeline at the moment, and the board have still to have sight of that plan and effectively sign that plan off. And that's something we'll work very closely with Scottish Canals as we go through our planning for the audit this year. And as you would expect, this is something we'll keep very close to in terms of the actions that Scottish Canals are taking to rectify the issues identified.
Auditor General, just turning to a slightly different aspect of this, the report makes it clear that the cost of running Scottish Canals is actually exceeds the funding and income. So paragraph 11 says that 2021 the income was 18.8, but the outgoings were 22.7. So that's a net negative of 3.9. What are your views on the sustainability, financial sustainability of Scottish Canals?
So one of the requirements of external auditors of public bodies in Scotland is to express a judgment on the financial sustainability of public bodies, as well as financial management, governance and leadership arrangements, as well as any opinion on the financial statements, Mr. Beattie. So I think really just building on the response I gave to Mr. Hoy, that we're not identifying core financial sustainability issues with Scottish Canals business. The main thrust of today's report is the basis of the valuation concerns and the need to tackle this. But we do make the connection that the nature of Scottish Canals business is to maintain the Scotland's inland waterways, and that requires considerable ongoing maintenance investment. Touched on already that as an organisation it's played an important role in regeneration activity around Scotland's canals. So looking to the future, it's in the process of updating its medium-term financial strategy. And I think that will be the key point of judgment, first of all, for the Board of Scottish Canals to assess its own judgment about its financial sustainability, and then from an audit perspective to follow on from that. So whilst, you know, as we sit today, we aren't raising red flags about Scottish Canals' financial sustainability, but with any public body, you know, they'll want to keep that under close review.
Your report also states there's a maintenance backlog of £70 million. I mean, that's a heck of a lot for an organisation of this size and with the resources it's got. How on earth did it get to that level?
Yeah, Joanna might want to say a bit more about the background to it as well. Backlog maintenance isn't unique to Scottish Canals. I would say, you know, it's a regular feature of public bodies that are managing large, complex asset bases, and their ability to keep all of these assets up to date in the condition that's to be expected is really on the basis of a prioritisation. So valuations and reviews of maintenance requirements have arrived at the figure to return it to ideal condition. And it will be a choice for Scottish Canals, as it's been a choice for where they have prioritised their investment in years gone by. Whether they will return to a place where they have invested £70 million or more will be dependent both on the financial strategy that they produce and also the delivery of their estates or asset management strategy that accompanies it. So the background to it, I'll maybe turn to Joanne just about some of the decisions that have gone in years preceding today's report. Joanne.
So Scottish Canals have in place and have had in place for a period of time an asset management plan. Typically, the asset management plan has spanned 10 to 12 years and it's annually reviewed and considered. And as the Auditor General mentioned, the historic nature of these assets has been considered within that asset management plan. And that asset management plan considers the assets according to risk, according to priority, according to information that they have around inspections of those assets. And it's been recognised by Scottish Canals that they need to take some decisions on how they invest in the canals infrastructure based on the funding and the financial monetary sums they can afford to put back into maintaining the canal. So there is judgments within that. And they need to then balance that longer term asset management plan with one-off potential incidences in year where there is an asset failure, where they then need to go in and repair that asset. So that's something they constantly recognise within the asset management plan is recognised as a risk on the corporate risk register around the backlog maintenance. And they continue to talk to the sponsor team around the future funding and how that can be funded going forward.
Thank you, Vera.
Yeah, thanks, Colin. I want to just probe a little bit more into the fact that we are sitting with a report which has got a disclaimer on the audit opinion attached to it. So I think in paragraph 3 of the report, on page 2, it says, and I quote, Scottish Canals had not obtained a valuation for around £51 million of specialist operational assets which had been capitalised between 2012 and 2021. Would you have expected a public corporation, which is what Scottish Canals was during that period, to have had these assets valued?
What we're saying in the report, Convener, is that there's, as you know, £51 million of specialist operational assets that didn't have a valuation. Joanne, I'm sure, maybe want to take the committee through some of the valuations that were obtained, subsequent valuations that happened during the year, and then some of the concerns that Grant Thornton had about the material that they were presented with and how that then relayed to the information that was stored in the fixed asset register. Part of the background to this is that the requirement upon Scottish Canals for valuation evolved as they moved from being a public corporation into a non-departmental body, with the additional obligations around what that meant for how they recorded their assets, disclosed them in their financial report and accounts. What we have today, though, is the ultimate, Joanne, I'm sure we'll say more, is a disclaimer of audit opinion because the auditor wasn't able to obtain the evidence necessary to sign off on the set of accounts. What went before, Joanne can take the committee through.
Happy to pick up on those points. As a public corporation, they were accounting primarily under Companies Act requirements, so therefore they weren't required to physically have a valuation of the assets, the capital spend. It was held at historic cost and then depreciated over the useful life. Under the FREM, the accounting treatment changes, and they are required to have a valuation. They identified and commissioned a valuer prior to our audit starting for land and buildings, which is maybe about circa 8 million of the balance on the balance sheet. But the 51 million of assets that they were holding determined as specialist assets, they didn't request a valuation. This came to light during our external audit year-end work in May, June, where we then had conversations with management around the need for the valuation in order to demonstrate compliance with the accounting requirements. When we then started to look at the detail of the underlying records of the £51 million, coupled with the valuation they subsequently got in October, we had concerns around the suitability of the audit evidence and management's records. The fixed asset register itself, the descriptions in the fixed asset register made it quite difficult to understand what was the exact asset. And it's quite important in terms of accounting terms, whether we needed to understand if it was a new asset that they were then bringing in, or if it was a repair or an enhancement of an existing asset. The way the fixed asset register was set up, you wouldn't have been able to tell whether old assets had been effectively written out of the fixed asset register. We had some concerns around potential duplication and double counting between the valuation of the specialist assets and what was recorded in the fixed asset register. For example, a number of investment properties were subject to valuation. We were comfortable with those valuations, but some of the balance that makes up this £51 million contributed to the investment property. So we were unclear whether that was effectively a double count. And then within the asset register, it holds a number of assets as a component of assets. Those were then wrapped up into individual assets, which the valuer sought to value in October, November last year. But within that, there was actually different types of assets where we would then have an audit challenge around, is the useful life of those individual components the correct allocation of that, and is the valuation basis correct? So in some cases, it was the 51 specialist assets include things like infrastructure assets, bridges, roads, towpaths. And it also included some specialist engineering type assets, lock pile, sea gates. But within that, there was also an element which was land, and that would actually have a different valuation basis. So the actual records that Scottish Canals had to support the valuation and what the individual assets were lacking. And then there was a challenge around the subsequent valuation that they did get, which was around about October, November time, which obviously came later than our audit work. So there was a number of factors which caused us concern around the fixed assets and the subsequent valuation. And as the Auditor General outlined, a disclaimer opinion is really unusual. I've only ever signed two. It's just the two you've seen. But in terms of why it was a disclaimer, when you actually look at the balances in the financial statements where these transactions would hit, we weren't then able to say whether it was materially or otherwise misstated. And that could be if capital was incorrectly treated and should have been expenditure. If the useful lives were incorrect, that would have an impact on depreciation. There was an impact on revaluation reserves. So the impact of the £51 million hit a number of financial statement line items, which we therefore thought was pervasive across the accounts, which led to the disclaimer itself.
Thank you. I think that's really helpful. I mean, one thing that occurs to me when we're having this session is... So I understand that Scottish Canals was transferring its status from being a public corporation to being a non-departmental public body, and that led to a change in its accounting requirements. But I mean, does Scottish Natural Heritage, does Scottish Water have a fixed asset register? What about ScotRail in the future? Will that need to have a fixed asset register? I mean, where does this sit in a spectrum of other organisations?
Convener, any public body that are managing assets should have a fixed asset register, and that it's a core component of how they would manage the maintenance, the recording of assets. As Joanne touches on, it's not necessarily just the overall asset that you can see, but it's very often subdivided into what's known as components of different items that make up an asset that may have different useful lives. And that ought to link clearly, transparently into the depreciation, the management of the asset, and the associated financial reporting that's disclosed in respect of the assets. So it's a fairly usual expected thing that a fixed asset register needs to be recorded, needs to be updated, and those records are accurate.
Okay, thank you. And so, I mean, there are other circumstances where a valuation might be applied prior to a change of ownership. And we've seen that in the past where... so, for example, with ScotRail, where the ownership of the franchise is changing, would you expect there to be, on transfer date, some kind of fixed asset register so that the Scottish Government that was taking on the asset would know what Abellio was handing over to it?
In that context, Convener, yes. So, as you know, we haven't done any work on that yet. But the auditors, whether it's the outgoing or the incoming auditors, will look at opening balances, which I think effectively is to be satisfied of the disclosures that are being inherited. And I think, really building on some early conversation, the same applies to the incoming board and accountable officers will also want that assurance. So whether that's from external auditors or internal auditors, they'll want to be clear on the assets and liabilities that the organisation is inheriting. In respect of Scottish Canals, you know, so the fixed asset register is a vital component of this organisation, given what it does. You know, to maintaining Scotland's inland waterways, it's a key feature of their work. And I think all the more reason that the focus on resolving the issues that we report today are done over the course of this year and reported at the end of December as intended.
Yeah, and just for completeness, so the entirety of the canal network has never been valued in its entirety or disclosed in accounts produced by Scottish Canals. I mean, what's the reason for that? Is it because it's old Victorian structures that have never been properly assessed since they were built centuries ago? Or is there another reason? Why is it?
Largely, as you described, Convener, actually about the requirements before Scottish Canals became a non-departmental body didn't require them to have the type of valuations that they now do since becoming an NDPB. So there has been a change of status. So I think as Joanne might want to say a bit more about the valuation methodologies that are now with Scottish Canals, moving from a historical basis to a depreciated replacement cost, existing use, some of the requirements are now on Scottish Canals. So I don't wish to understate the significance. It's a big piece of work, and I think that's some of the judgments that we make in the report, that it is a significant piece of work that is required of Scottish Canals this year to resolve the valuation concerns that we talk about in today's report. All the more reason that there's good governance oversight of the project over the course of this year. But if you're content, Convener, Joanne might want to say a bit more about the valuation arrangements now and what went before.
So in terms of what went before, when Scottish Canals came into existence in 2012, there was effectively an asset register agreement between British Waterways and Scottish Canals. What that happened to have was these assets transferring to Scottish Canals with effectively a nil net book value, recognising the canal network and the canal assets itself as effectively a heritage, historic monument type of asset, which couldn't be subject to valuation and therefore was held at residual nil value. Over time, Scottish Canals have obviously invested in the canal network and undertaken a number of repairs. And as part of those repairs, there's been enhancements to the canal network. What's been quite challenging for Scottish Canals to then think through is, for example, some of the spend this year within that specialist asset category was an enhancement to a reservoir, but the actual reservoir itself is not held on the canals books and not attributed a value. So the conversations are around, well, is it the actual reservoir you should be valuing, or is it this piece of work that you've done within the reservoir? And actually, what does that mean in terms of valuation? There would be a challenge, and that's something Scottish Canals are in discussion with the sponsor team on how would you put a value on a canals network. It's not quite the same as a trunk road. It's not used in the same way. And would ultimately Scottish Government want to have the whole canal network attributed a value and on Scottish Government's books effectively? So that's an ongoing conversation Scottish Canals are needing to have to understand in the first instance why they would want to have capital assets and why they would want to hold them in this way, And then once they better understand the nature of the capital asset, they'd be better placed to determine its valuation. Because over time, all this work is being capitalised. So effectively over time, if they continue this way, they will inadvertently give the whole canal network a value. And I'm not necessarily sure that's what the intention is. And that's something that canals management are looking at further.
Thank you. I think, there are still quite a few unanswered questions here that that we'll need to consider how best we respond to. But I know Willie Coffey's got some questions as well to raise.
Thanks, Convener. Auditor General, it seems that the transition from Scottish Canals from a public body to the NDPB is what has brought about many or most of these issues. And I'm looking at your report in paragraph 10 there, saying that transition or that decision came as a result of a review by the Office for National Statistics to change its status from public body to NDPB. Did no one think that they were putting a bit of a millstone around its neck and the changing requirements that Joanne described earlier were quite substantial? There's a substantial difference in how you account for these assets if you're one type of body or the other. Did nobody think about that before they made the decision to change the status of the organisation?
It's a really interesting point, Mr Coffey, actually. And I'm going to bring Graham in, actually, because he might just provide a bit of additional context and background for the committee. And you might recall, Mr Coffey, that in the predecessor committee, that decisions that the Office for National Statistics have made in terms of other capital projects, Graham might want to say a bit more about the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, for example, was one of the previous special purpose vehicle that went around, that was also one of the consequences of a call that the Office for National Statistics made. I think before Graham wants to say anything on that, is that the ONS will make its own decisions about it, and across the UK it will determine its judgment on the status and the activity of individual public bodies and into which category they best fall. Clearly they took a judgment that Scottish Canals, by way of its relationship with government, was better described as a non-departmental public body than a public corporation. But the knock-on implications of that were very significant, as we're seeing today. And, you know, as Joanne describes, the complexities of the previous valuation arrangements and what then fell upon Scottish Canals. But in terms of the decisions, which initially might appear relatively innocuous, can have serious repercussions. And maybe actually, I think it's probably worth hearing from Graham actually just about how that's been dealt with previously.
Thank you, Auditor General. Yeah, the work of the ONS in this kind of area, it's not entirely uncommon for body's status to change as a result of ONS reviews, but it is fairly unusual. It tends to happen for arm's length bodies that are kind of at the boundaries of the public sector, which have features of a kind of trailing nature. So one recent example that you might remember the committee considering was the special purpose vehicle set up to deliver the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, part of the non-profit distributing project. So the ONS was responsible for classifying whether the privately financed projects are under public sector control or private sector control, using guidance prepared by Eurostat, the European Statistical Body. And back in 2015, ONS concluded that because the public sector had effective vetoes over key aspects of the project and a share of the project surpluses, then the NPD project was under public sector. And cutting a long story short, that basically meant that the Scottish Government halted non-profit distributing as a method of delivering private finance projects, and it delivered. It changed the way in which they were going to do private finance projects, through introducing the mutual investment model to avoid that kind of ONS review resulting in the the special purpose vehicle being regarded as being under public sector control. I think it's fair to say that the ONS tends not to think too much about the implications of its decisions in the way that Mr. Coffey kind of outlined there. You know, it tends to be looking at the wider picture and the whether these public bodies, where they sit within the national accounting boundaries.
Thanks for that, Graham. I mean, I'm just still reading the report or the general there. That change was made, that status change was made only April 2020. You could argue that they would struggle to be able to deliver the extent of the fixed asset register re-examination or revaluation in that particular time frame. But it's probably more importantly to ask you now, Auditor General, is are they getting on with it now? Are you confident that the organisation is aware of what needs to be done, the demands that are in the FREM, as you've outlined there and Joanne described to us, and does the organisation have the skills and capacity to get the work done now as quickly as they possibly can?
Yeah, maybe address both those points, Mr. Coffey. Actually, I think whilst the status change happened in April 2020, I think we would point to that there was awareness of the implications of the status change for at least a year beforehand that might have allowed for some of the circumstances that we're reporting today to have been avoided. In terms of whether we're able to give you the necessary assurance that over the course of this year that all of the necessary work will be carried out, it's probably not yet, unfortunately. You know, and Joanne will want to say a bit more about what she's seen. So we know that this is a complex task. Scottish Canals recognise that it is a complex set of work that's undertaken and that they have arrangements progressing to tackle the issue. I think the point that we made and said a couple of times today is that the Board of Scottish Canals will want to assure itself that the necessary skills, project steps are in place to tackle and deliver upon this project. Joanne's mentioned already that, you know, through our external audit work, we'll track and monitor that and consider, you know, further public reporting as necessary. But I'll hand over to Joanne just to say a bit more about how Scottish Canals are tackling and what their intentions are this year. Joanne.
I think Joanna has frozen. So we are, I don't think we're able to fix that, in which case I'm going to, I think, reflect. I don't know whether Auditor General, there's anything else you want to say.
Thanks, Katrina. I think, really just briefly, again, as mentioned to Mr. Coffey, that we know that Scottish Canals are making plans to tackle this issue, but and it is a significant task. You know, I think as we've said a number of times already and touched on in the report, and it needs to be carefully managed with the right resource, the level of expertise, whether Scottish Canals have that expertise in-house or not, therefore bringing in the necessary subject matter experts to support them in the valuation process. It's a big, complex project. Of course, they'll want support from the Scottish Government and their sponsor team to deliver upon this and manage it, report it transparently throughout the course of the year. And as I've mentioned, Mr. Coffey, we'll continue to monitor that through our audit work and Joanne's team.
Thanks for that.
Right. Thank you very much indeed. And we are now out of time, so I'm going to thank the Auditor General, as always, for providing us with a useful insight into the report, and thank Joanne Brown, who joined us online, and Graham Greenhill as well, both for the evidence that you've given us this morning, which has given us quite a lot of food for thought. So thank you very much indeed. And I am now going to move the committee meeting into private session. Thank you.